Good morning.
My name is Paul Tiska. I'm with CSI. I want to thank Dr. Golzar for inviting us and having us support this breakfast symposium. I have the honor of introducing Dr. Alan Block from The Ohio State University, a DPM, and he's going to speak to us about the cost of calcium. Dr. Block.
Thank you. All right, so let's wake you up a little bit in the morning. As you know, there's a big contingent of podiatrists that come to this, but I'm going to talk to you, if you're doing interventions, endovascular interventions, what it means to us, what it means to podiatrists, and what events and things are happening. Now, I've been in the endovascular world for about, eight, 9 years, and it started very interesting for me in that the Silverhawk device brought me into the space, and it was a revolution because patients I couldn't have treated before were being treated, and we were able to do some wonderful things with that. But even more importantly than that, what came from it is the next step was the evolution into calcium. And we're going to talk about the cost of calcium because one of the hardest things for me to treat, and now with the ability to be able to treat it, it's been great. So if we go on from this, very simply, I'm going to run through this. 26 million people in the United States are living with diabetes. 8 million are undiagnosed. We know that. And very, very simply, it turns out 1 in 3 people by 2050 will be diabetic. So 1 in 3 children born in the year 2000 or after are now going to be diabetic, which is a little frightening. Because it turns out, if you start to look at this, it turns out that 11% of our healthcare expenditures are being spent on treating diabetics. Now, we know diabetes comes with a lot of comorbidities, and a lot of these patients, it turns out, are having a lot to do with why they're showing up in our office and the treatment and calcium. Every 7 seconds, someone dies from diabetes, and every 17 seconds, someone is diagnosed with diabetes, and unfortunately, every 20 seconds, someone has an amputation from diabetes. And that comes out to 4,320 legs per day that are being amputated. And there's a lot of these patients who have physical options that they are not aware of at this point. But who's at risk? Very simply, we're all at risk. But you know what happens? Very casually over time, we start to put on a few pounds every year. We get a little bit older. We don't exercise as much. But we still see ourselves as 17-year-old athlete. And a very, very simple thing about this, if you look at this picture, this is a prime patient, not grossly obese or anything like this. But very simply, a couple rules she's breaking. First of all, the stripe should be on her suit, not on her seat. And the second thing is, she should never sit on anything smaller than your behind. But the scary part about this picture is, the only person or living being in this picture that understands this woman's in trouble is that dog. And that dog doesn't have enough leash to get away, right? So the thing about it is, this is kind of how sometimes I feel about our patients. We're tethered to patients who refuse to get better. It's not that they don't want to get better, they just don't want to do the steps to take it. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So it turns out, again, in the United States, 8.3% of the population is now diabetic. 4.9% of the patient population of India is now 4.9 or 5% of them are diabetic type 2. 6.7% of the population of China is now type 2 diabetic. And 1 in 400 children now living in the United States are not only type 1 diabetic, they are obese. So we're not doing really well. And if you went to Florence, Italy, and you ever saw the Statue of David, right, the embodiment of what a man or boy should look like, this is what he looked like after living in the United States for about a year. So the Mediterranean diet's not really working well for us here. But it turns out, Craig Walker says, for some reason it's considered conservative treatment to chop someone's leg off and aggressive treatment to do even an angiogram. And you know what? 10 years ago, when we got into this space, we said, hey, you know what? We need these patients treated. We need vascular testing. We need angiograms. It makes sense to do. You know, we do colonoscopies because they're 50. Why don't we do a routine angiogram on these patients, especially if they have the protocol that needs this? And it turns out that less than 40% of the patients, even today, before they have an amputation, get an angiogram. And less than 50% get an ABI. And you can do an ABI in your office in about 10 minutes. So it doesn't make sense because these people are losing legs, and they're losing limbs, and they're losing their life. And the scary part about that is we have treatment options for these patients, and they come to us for that. So the thing about it is, before we lose someone's leg, before we take it off, it makes sense that we should be discussing with these patients their options. Because if you give patients their options, if you tell them there's treatment options, they'll likely go for it. Because it turns out it's not conservative treatment to amputate a leg. And it turns out in the United States there are 180,000 amputations per year, in the United States. 60% of those are due to diabetes. 20-25% of diabetics will lose some part of their foot or leg in their lifetime. And the scary part is 5-8% with a below-knee amputation will die in the hospital in the first 30 days. If it's an above-knee amputation, as you can see here, 8-12% of those patients will die in the first 30 days. 18 to 24 month follow-out on these patients after an amputation, 40 to 50% of them will die. And depending on what papers you decide to read, over a five-year mortality rate, 72 to 92% of these people will die in the first 5 years. So amputations are not benign. We're actually killing people. And it turns out that global warming is not necessarily green gases. I think we're getting larger, emitting more heat, and putting it off. Now, we all do this. We're getting larger, right? We become obese. Matter of fact, 2 weeks ago, we now declare obesity as a disease, which is a really, I'm not in favor of this, but we are calling it a disease. You know, last night when I flew in, we all do this, right? You get on the plane, the guy gets on, he's 400 pounds, historic legs, big belly, right? He asks for the belt extender, and he's walking down the aisle, and he's so big he has to go sideways, and he's looking at the seat next to you, and you're in the middle, and you put your head down in your hands, you go, God, if you let him sit in another seat, I'll start going to church on Sundays. Matter of fact, I'll pay for the next church. But we all do it, and we all are getting larger. So in a society, what's happening very simply around the world, what's happening is we're not taking care of ourselves, and these other disease states are really taking hold. And it turns out, when the patient comes in, they say to me, Dr. Block, you know why I didn't come in? Because my toe was black, because I know once you start cutting, you don't stop. And I try to explain to them they have to change their habits or I can't change mine. And doing the same thing over and over again is the definition of insanity. And I try to explain that to them. I, matter of fact, do a thing now where I have them sign, like a pain agreement, I have them sign an agreement what they're going to do, controlling their sugars, take their medicines, coming to see me regularly, that whole thing. And if they don't want to do it, they're no longer my patient. And you know, it's tough love, and I got to be honest with you, 9 out of 10, I should say 90 out of 100, once I give them this, stick with it, and maybe one leaves. But it turns out, when you look at this, you know, the endovascular world took hold of good many years ago. But you know, very simply, if you take a 5/32nd incision, make it about the groin, and you go over the horn contralateral side, and you introduce the device, it makes sense. Because even though vascular surgery has gone forward from this, and they don't have to open them, you know, stem to stern, the problem is my patients usually are too sick to undergo this procedure and survive, so they aren't getting it done. There's not a problem with it, except now you're taking my vein, and the problem with you take a vein, now I'm dealing with lymphedema, and it becomes a problem. And the other side is, it turns out a lot of these patients are vasculopaths, they're diabetic, they restenose, so it's a procedure that you may have to do over and over again. And that's that do-over I always wanted as a kid. Well, it turns out that less than half the amputees with the above or below knee amputation will ever walk again, and 25%, if they have an above knee amputation, will ever walk again. 5 to 9% die in the hospital in the first 30 days. 25% require nursing home placement, and in the state of Ohio, that's $107,000 a year. 1/3 of the amputees will lose the remaining leg within 18 months. In the United States, the amputation rate is increasing, and hospitalized patients with diabetes are 28 times more likely to have an amputation. Now, another little fact about that is 80% of the diabetics who are hospitalized are done because they have an infected diabetic ulcer. So CMS, the government's trying to figure out how they can stop that. So it turns out, here's where I was. So about 10 years ago, again, endovascular treatment was brought to me, and they said, hey, listen, why don't you send us your patients, because we think we can go down from the hip and maybe down to the ankle and start to save these patients' lives. And I have this great contingent of little Italian women. They come in, and they're at the end of their lives. They're the matriarch of the family. They come in with the whole family, and they're afraid to ask if they're dying. They know they are, but they don't want the family to know they know. And they said this to me, Dr. Block, don't let me die without my legs on. And for the first time, I'm helpless. And there's nothing worse, as you know, as a physician or a nurse or a healthcare provider, when you can't do anything except keep the wound clean and walk out of the room praying that she dies before she loses her legs. Well, you know what? That has changed. That has changed. The second thing she said to me that really threw me off, she said, Dr. Block, I want to go home one more time and make meatballs. And I went, wow, losing your legs, meatballs? It really didn't make a lot of sense to me. And one day it hit me, because I started hearing, I want to go home one more time, I want to do this. They're comfortable at home. They're afraid to tell their family they're afraid of dying. And this is what they said to me. They wanted to let me know they wanted to go home. And I was really looking. So when I'm a resident in San Francisco, my director didn't want people with dry gangrene coming to the office, because dry gangrene smells, it's rotting flesh. And if you're sitting next to a person with rotting flesh in your office, people think your office is filthy. So he would have me go at night and change their bandages. And he told me this when I first started. Listen, when you go and a toe or something falls off in your hand, just put it in a bag, bring it to me, and I'll dispose of it in the morning. And it sounded good until that first one broke off and fell into my hand. And I remember putting it in a plastic bag and sealed it, and a second plastic bag, and I sealed it. And yet a third plastic bag, and then a paper bag. I set it on a stack of newspapers in my car, and I couldn't wait to get to his office in the morning to dispose of that toe. I barely slept. 3 months later, toe fell off, bag, threw it in the back of my car with the rest of the McDonald's bags, and I was good to go. I became desensitized to what I was doing. I became desensitized to the fact that that patient was sitting away and rotting in bed. Well, the thing is, 10 years ago, they brought me the paddle that I home to bring you today. So, basically, bottom line, cost of calcium. Let me explain how important this is. It turns out that the greatest growing population is 85 years and older at this point. So, the three buckets we're looking at, advanced age, 65 to 85. At 75, we know these patients, a good predictor, these patients have calcium. Number two is diabetics, 12 years with or without neuropathy. If they have neuropathy, and it could be type 1 or type 2, these patients are great calcium formers, right? Very, very simple. And kidney disease, sorry, not end-stage kidney disease, but we're looking at kidney disease, period. Now, these people are known to be great formers of calcium. And calcium, it turns out, is responsible for the loss of limbs and loss of tissue and ulcerations. It turns out, when you go on very simply, when you start to put peripheral arterial disease in perspective, the 5-year mortality rate is about 30%. But when you get to critical limb ischemia, it stands alone, and very simply, 61% of these people will be dead in 5 years. If you combine those two together, you can see the numbers. And again, when you start to look at colorectal cancer, when you start to look at breast cancer, they don't even measure up to these. Yet breast cancer is the best funded cancer in the world. And the thing is, it happens to very young, vital women. This disease you usually have from infancy, but it catches up to you. I call them diseases of longevity, right? They are diseases of longevity. And it turns out that I was at New Cardiovascular Horizons about a month ago, and this very case, the patient who was supposed to be done on live television or live video, was too sick to be done. So they went to this case here, very similar. And what they were doing is they were just gonna pass through and be done. Well, it turns out this lesion was calcified. And it turns out the case was gonna take 10 minutes, was a 2-hour in and out when they finally crossed it. But the interesting part is, as I'm reading the literature, it turns out that angioplasty misses calcium 74% of the time. 74% of the time it's missing calcium. And it's an amazing type of thing because calcium is one of those things that a lot of times you can't get across. But it turns out that Ray Dottillo was kind enough to show me this. This is, you can see he has stenosis in two parts of very simply, when you look at this, he had it at the top and also at the bottom. Well, the first thing he did is he passed through with orbital atherectomy, but he only did the plantar grade or lesion here. And then he went in with a balloon and blew it up. And the problem is he caused a dissection. Now, the paper by Fitzgerald in 1996, he's an interventional cardiologist trained at Stanford, he simply said he took 22 peripherals and 19 cardiac cases, and he found that if he blew up a balloon in the presence of calcium, he had a dissection 74% of the time. And 80% of those dissections were class C or above, or rate or flow limiting lesions. That's what he found out to do. So you go forward about 15 years or so, this still stands true. Now, what happened in Ray's case is he went in, and again, he used orbital atherectomy to clean out the calcium, didn't realize the top lesion was calcified as well, and what ended up happening again is that dissection. Well, this became the really important part for me because these 7 points really make it home. It turns out calcium can be predicted. ABI, now I do ABIs all the time. I have it done at the vascular lab, actually, but it turned out that I thought anything over 1 or below 1 needed to be treated, and I still feel that way. But it turned out 1.1 does not necessarily mean the patient is calcified, nor does 1.2. But 1.3 is the predictor that that vessel is calcified. So I already know I'm going into a calcified vessel. The next thing is critical limb ischemia is 0.4 below on an ABI. But it turns out that critical limb ischemia is calcification. One is, very simply this, if it's above 1.3, the vessel is calcified. If it's below 0.4, critical limb ischemia, the vessel is occluded by calcium. So it's the same animal. But the thing about this is the patient who we're not getting treated as quickly as we need. And it turns out, why aren't we crossing this lesion when it's 75% blockage? It turns out that when you find claudication, if you follow a patient, you give them the lifestyle, the medication, you treat them well, if you look in a year, how many patients with claudication will go to critical limb ischemia in 1 year, it turns out that maybe 2 to 6% of those patients, so not a great deal of it. But if you take that bucket list I showed you before, you take the 75 years old patient, the patient with renal disease, the patient with diabetes, any three of those, or together, and it turns out that the most conservative paper I've read says 31% of those patients will go to critical limb ischemia within a year. Now, 31 to 37% of those patients go to critical limb ischemia, and we could have crossed it, and now we can't. So why aren't we crossing? And what I read is the standard tells me not to. The standard says that you don't have to cross that patient, and that doesn't make sense because now I can't do anything with that patient, and I'm sitting riding a wound that I can't heal. But it turns out, as you go on, diabetes, again, 12 years standing diabetes with or without neuropathy, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter type 1 or type 2. Calcium found in a 4-foot x-ray. So if you're taking a look at a calcium, you can see that dorsalis pedis is calcified. I already know when I'm sending that patient to get looked at for an endovascular procedure, I already now can check the form and I say, patient definitely has calcium. So you already know what I'm looking for. And I already know what kind of a mess I've got with this patient. The other thing is, very simply, history of tobacco use, which I don't have to talk to you about. We all know that. But creatinine, which I get on my standard patient admission testing, I look at this, and it turns out if their creatinine is greater than 1.7, it turns out that patient, a great predictor, that that patient is calcified. And the last thing is GFR, which, again, we also know that creatinine is part of that, but two standalone markers. So these seven markers, when I look at them, I am now sending my patients, and I'm telling the doctor what I think this patient has, which makes it better for him or her and myself, but it makes it better for the patient. It turns out that I'm at a football game, and this guy takes his shirt off. Now, I don't know why he takes his shirt off, but he does. And soon enough, I forget a football game's going on, right? I'm staring at his back. The thing about this is, I'm watching this guy, and again, I'm looking, maybe electrolysis, maybe shaving his back. I don't know what but he has to do something. But he takes his back, you know, he takes that shirt off. And this is the same thing. Once I know you have the ability to treat these patients, I will start sending these patients. And I cannot tell you how well you're trained and how well we're, and you know what, we're underserved because I don't know this exists until you tell me. It doesn't matter how good your hands or your abilities. If you don't tell me, if you don't tell the world that this exists, that you have the ability to do these kind of treatments, I won't know to send these patients. And you know what, I'll sit on them. I'll sit on them. And we can't do that. And if you ask a podiatrist or a family doctor, they don't know these patients can be treated, so they don't send them. Because they don't know that what happened in the endovascular world. They don't know that we can now go from the toe up to the hip. They're not sure of it. So the bottom line is, how do you treat society? Well, you know what? You come up with something endovascular. You come up with a turbo hawk. You come up with a diamond back. And you start to tell the world this exists. And you know what the thing about it is? You treat the pathology, and you have to change the psychology, not of the world, but of the treating physicians, because we're the hardest group. It takes about 5 years from something to go with vehemently hated to accept it as a gold standard. Look at balloon angioplasty in the heart, right? What happened? 1978, the first one's done here in the United States, and it's a joke, but it's a gold standard today. But it took years to get to the point where we didn't have to crack a chest. So you know how you treat society? You disseminate the information like they did in breast cancer. Breast cancer had a 5-year mortality rate of 17%, and about 10 years ago, they came out with a national campaign. They made a pink ribbon, they named a race after it, and breast cancer has fallen from 17% to 11% in about 5 years because they told people it existed. Women started getting mammograms and examinations. And you know what? We need to do the same thing in this space. Again, 11% of the medical dollar is being spent on this. So it turns out, one of the biggest concerns I had about the calcium, it was that orbital atherectomy. I was told very simply that with orbital atherectomy, my patients were going to have emboli, and they were going to lose their feet because they were going to lose circulation. And it turned out, I started asking the interventionalists who were doing this, I'm afraid of this procedure. And they said, no. If you throw a bucket of sand down the toilet, you're going to clog it. But if you do it a cup at a time, you won't. And it comes down to being able to use the device in the way it was designed to do. And it turns out that the particulate matter that gets sanded down or shaved down, it turns out that it's 93% smaller than the red blood cell and 99% smaller than the capillary that it's going to go through. And it turns out that a lot of my patients have now had this procedure done, and I've yet to see an emboli or a blue toe or a blue foot. But here's what really comes down to. It turns out, when you take a look at this, again, balloon angioplasty, most studied, probably the best thing we've ever found for below the knee. But as long as it's not in calcium. And I didn't realize that. Because I see all these numbers. When you look here, they would tell me the patency rate after balloon angioplasty and critical limb ischemia salvage procedures, they put up numbers of 96 to 86%, and I was comfortable with that. And still I started reading what they said. And the first caveat they have in these papers that I'm reading about limb salvage, turns out that if these patients have calcium, they're excluded from the study. So those rates really fall down to 51% patency rate at 1 year, and 36% patency rate at 2 years. These are not acceptable. And my patient with calcium is not even counted because either they're not counting them or they're not taking care of them in the first place. They're let out of the study. Turns out when you put a stent in, it turns out 28% of the stents fracture. And it was really kind of interesting because Kurt Scheinhardt, from Leipzig, Germany, came over, and he explained why stents break. They break in the presence of calcium. So calcium has become a very big problem that we really weren't doing much with because we didn't have the ability or the instrumentation to do it. Again, very simply, when I started to look at this is very simply what happened here. Again, you can see very, very simply the calcium in the arterial wall there. And what happened, they went down and they put in a stent. And the problem with the stent was the radial force was not enough to keep the calcium. You can see the stent didn't stay opened up. The radial force pushed it down. So they went through with a balloon. They blew that balloon up to 12 atmospheres. So I'm reading the papers, and it turns out the more atmospheres you go up, the more smooth muscle DNA you kill. So you have a better chance of restenosis. And I'm thinking, this is written in the literature, and I can say it, and I don't do this procedure. So what happened is once they blew up the balloon, they went back out, and you can see the calcium still exists. And the truth of the matter is, if you change the morphology of the plaque from hard to soft, you can then treat it. So you get the calcium out, right? Orbital atherectomy, take the calcium out, and then you can go through with atherectomy or a stent or a balloon, whatever you're comfortable with, and you can treat the soft plaque. We know that. I've been reading the literature. I know paclitaxel is coming. I know about the cutting balloons. I read all of this. And it makes sense if you have an artery that is open and you're more closer to the intima or the media, you can simply lay down that medication. And it would make more sense that it's going to stay open longer. And I know the trials are going on for that right now, so I'm not going to report on them. But it turns out, very simply, this is really important here. It turns out a reintervention is about $28,000. The average cost to heal a wound in 1996 of an ulcer was $17,000, $18,000. Today it's $48,000. It's an amazing type of thing. So CMS is trying to figure it out. We're using all kinds of things today, right? We're using wound vacs, we're using artificial skins. We're throwing everything at these we can possibly do. Amputation, the average amputation costs about $50,000. The average cost to keep that patient in an extended care facility is $49,000, and the annual cost to keep them in that nursing home with nursing care is another $48,000. So you're talking $200,000 to keep that patient in a nursing home after an amputation before a prosthesis. Now, you have to realize that most of these people are taking an enormous amount of medical supplies and treatment because they're very sick. So it turns out this is the evolution of what we're going to demand. I'm driving to Kentucky to give this presentation just before lunch. And it turns out that I stopped at Burger King to get something, to get a big iced tea, right? It was halfway there. And it turns out they had a placard on the counter, and that placard simply said this. It said they had something called a quad stack. And a quad stack is a Whopper cheese bacon, Whopper cheese bacon, Whopper cheese bacon, Whopper cheese bacon, bun, whatever else, is 1,700 calories, and they have a breakfast sandwich. Now, I get to Kentucky, this is 1996, and the big news is we're going below the knee, BTK. One reason I learned not to talk in BTKs and SFAs, and because I was talking BTK, it's just before lunch, they're tired and they're hungry. I keep saying BTK, they're thinking Burger King, okay? That's what they're thinking. And I am breaking this news. We've just shattered it. We're going all the way down. We're going below, we're going to the tibial vessels. So the joke became that Burger King will get you on the table, and then a below-knee trained endovascular physician can get you off that table with your leg intact. But here's the important part. This is the big take-home. If you look at wound care healing, 31% of wounds heal. 31%. That means 69% of these patients are not healing. Now, my biggest problem, I was sending a patient in with an ulcer that had it for a year or two. I couldn't heal it, but I could sustain it. And every once in a while, they got a bad infection. I kept escalating the antibiotic. And I would send them in with one vessel runoff below the knee, and I'd get them back saying, block, they have one vessel runoff below the knee. It was enough to maintain the ulcer, but not enough to heal it. And the problem for me is, I don't want that. I need this patient healed. I needed them healed. And you know what happened? They started to go below the knee, and they started to open all the vessels. And we'll talk about that, because very, very simply, the literature says, open all the vessels you possibly can. Now, 85% of amputations are preceded by a foot ulcer, and 80% again of hospital admissions to diabetics are due to the fact that a patient has an infected foot ulcer, okay? And again, look at the top. We look very simply that a wound's supposed to be half the size in 4 weeks or supposed to change up the treatment. Now, the interesting part is two things. There's a Vanderbilt calcium study. Maybe you've heard of Vanderbilt. It's a nice little school. It's down in Nashville. But the interesting part about it, they did a study, and what they were looking at, there's no international calcium score. And what they started looking at is why these patients were amputated. And they came out when they started looking at the calcium in these people. It turned out the tissue loss was caused by calcium. It turned out that amputation most likely was caused by amputation. And they found the higher the calcium, the better chance these people were going to have an amputation. And then there's another place called the Cleveland Clinic, and I'm reading their paper. Dan Clare wrote this. It turned out they had taken off 66 legs. That is 33 people. They had taken off these legs, and the interesting part, after they took off these legs, they had frozen them. The interesting part about that is they had done an angiogram within 6 months of the amputation. They went back and they tried to IVUS these patients, and they couldn't get through with IVUS. They tried to re-angiogram these legs after they thawed them out, and they couldn't get through. And they finally went down and hand-dissected each one. And what they came out with this paper is all 66 legs were lost due to the fact that these patients had calcium. That was it. They had calcium. And 66 legs, or 33 people, lost their legs. And an amazing kind of thing. And it turns out that what Vanderbilt came up with is that calcium is CLI, is amputation. So it's associated mass. CLI is amputation. Very, very simply, calcium is amputation. It's the reason they have the tissue loss in the first place. But it goes back to this. After reading 84 papers and looking through this, and a lot of it is not in podiatry, it's not in intravascular medicine, it's in kidney disease. It's amazing when you start to look at this. It turns out, what happened before we started using all these wonderful things like the VAC, before we started hyperbarics, before we started doing all these treatments, if we simply restore the flow on these patients? I have the mindset that I believe that if we did that, we'd have a greater than 31% healing rate. Now, I want to touch base here, and all I want you to see is this. So this is what got me interested in talking about orbital atherectomy and calcium, is this. The first thing I read was calcified lesions above the knee, and that was really interesting. And then I started finding out, if you go through and you change the plaque morphology from hard to soft, when you do put the balloon in, you have to use half the pressure. And I know that less pressure means less damage to the smooth muscle. And that was really kind of interesting. That was the first thing. But this really set me up, because the Calcium 360 study told me this. First of all, 95% of the patients were either severe to moderate calcification. They weren't excluded, they were included in this study. And that was the important part. And again, the same thing happened. Orbital atherectomy, it turns out the balloon pressures were a lot less. And I've changed the morphology, and my patients started to benefit from this. So that was the major study that I was looking at, and that's what convinced me that calcium needs to be treated. But here's the big thing. My biggest thing is, when I'm sitting with a group of vascular surgeons, and they're telling me, after they saw these cases, we watched five live cases, they said to me, Dr. Block, there's not one patient in that room that we would do an intervention on. And I said, well, why not? They said, our number one reason for doing it is pain. And all of a sudden, that bridge came into view, and that was this. My number one reason, my patients are diabetic, they're neuropathic, they can't tell me they have pain. And you know what? Pain is a great prognosticator bringing people to my office. Number one reason people come to see me is pain. You know what happened is I very simply started realizing, and that was our bridge we crossed. But the thing is, when I'm reading the literature, two from vascular medicine, two from interventional radiology, and two from interventional cardiology, all six papers say this. If you open one vessel below the knee, that's good. You open two, it's much better. And if you open three, that patient has a better chance of restoring a normal life and walking again and getting out of the medical, you know, the medical hubbub we've got them in. It turns out all papers say that. So the question is, why aren't doing it? I know it's hard. I understand that. But you know what? If you don't push the floor, you never see the ceiling. And I'm not interested in standards. I'm looking for the ceiling. I want it better, because I can't take my patients losing a leg. I can't take them dying on me, because I'm the guy they see every week. I'm the guy watching them go down. But the interesting part is, when I do an ABI, very simply, and I have the results and I show my patient this, I don't worry about waveforms anymore. I don't try to make it complicated. I go, that's the heartbeat of your leg. When that's flat, you're dead. Bottom line, period, it's over. So I want to show you a quick case that I was able to do because of intervention. Very, very simply, it's a 49-year-old patient. I'm sorry, and he is a train wreck. He is 10 months status post to pylon fracture they've been casting. He lives in West Virginia. He has a great support system. He comes to the university because he has a kidney, a pancreas transplant, immunosuppressive drugs, diabetic, peripheral vascular disease. About the only thing this guy doesn't do is smoke. And I want you to see this. So even if you're not an orthopedic or a podiatrist, you can basically see that that ankle should be underneath the leg, and he's lost about 8 centimeters of bone. Now, nobody wanted to touch him, and he came to me and said, I don't want my leg taken off. His family was 100% behind him. He's already been 10 months at this point. I said, it's going to make you another year or so to get this to heal, if we can. I sent him in. They did an intervention for him. They opened him up below the knee, and very simply, I'm going to skip through this as we take a look. His MRI, I'm just going to move. All I did was externally fixate him. He had a blood supply. I injected some growth factors into his ankle joint itself, but I never opened him up. And very simply, you can see as he goes along, he regenerated 8 centimeters of bone. And all I did was give him the topography, and the ability geography was already there. I didn't disturb the periosteum. He had blood supply, and he started to heal. Now, going on with these patients, you can see very simply, he's just doing beautifully. And in about 8, 10 months, I took him out of the external fixator. His ankle shot, he's neuropathic, and he was fine. He started to walk again because he regenerated it. But I want to tell you what happened to him. He lives in West Virginia, and he went to a local hospital because he got sick. And 3 months later, his other foot got infected. It passed the infection to his right leg, ended up having an amputation. The man came to me about 6 months later to apologize for losing his leg. He came to apologize to me. But that's what we can do in partnership with this. And if you tell me this exists, if you go out and you tell the family practitioner, you tell the internal medicine, you tell the endocrinologist what we're doing, or what you're able to do, we will partner with you, your practices will grow, and our patients will get better. Because, you know, Martin Luther King said this, very simply, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. And you know what? My job is to make sure that you know how much what you do matters to me, that matters to my patient. And I realize I can't work in a cubicle anymore. The cubicle I need to work in is the world. I need you. I need you to tell me you can do this. I need you to push the envelope. Basic bottom line is what we're doing here. So I appreciate your time. And one last thing. I know we're going to honor Dr. Mutarjame in just a moment, and I want to tell you something. He's been an inspiration for me as a podiatrist, and obviously I'm not an interventional radiologist, but his first patient, he's the first guy in Chicago to do a below knee balloon angioplasty in the 1960s on Ruth O'Grady. So Dr. Mutarjame, thank you so much, and thank you.
I love Dr. Block's passion about amputation prevention. That's exactly what we need, and that's what you're going to continue to see over the span of the next 3 days. Good morning, everyone. My name is Joffrey Golzar, and I would like to welcome you to the 3rd Annual Chicago Endovascular Conference. Before I begin, I'd like to thank all of our attendees. We have about 350 attendees this year from all across the country, about 51% from 47% from Illinois, and the rest from outside of state. I would like to thank our faculty, our scientific committee, and as well as our sponsors, without which we would not be able to do this meeting. And please visit the exhibit hall, visit their booths, and hear what they have to say. The CVC is very unique in that we have two simultaneous sessions, the arterial and venous sessions, that run throughout the span of the meeting. And so you can pick and choose. You want to see some arterial, PAD, limb salvage. You can go to the venous session, learn about sclerotherapy, phlebectomy. And it's very important to us to be very comprehensive and cover all aspects of endovascular intervention. You'll see cutting-edge technologies such as renal denervation, treatment of complex peripheral arterial disease, limb salvage, amputation prevention. This year we added hemodialysis access and intervention. We also partnered with ISIS, the International Society of Endovascular Specialists, and on Friday you're going to see the ISIS AAA Summit, which goes through complex aortic aneurysm repair. You're going to have significant amount of presence with our podiatrists and wound care, both basic and advanced wound care. And then when we get into the venous session, it's going to start off with venous anatomy, physiology, evaluating lower limits edema, learning about superficial and deep venous reflux. We're going to have live ultrasound demonstrations of venous disease and how to really evaluate these patients. Sclerotherapy, phlebectomy, and then we're going to go into deep venous disease, DVT, PE, learn about IVC filters. It's important to us also to be very practical. So, you know, we want to teach, we want to learn, we want to interact. So you're going to see a lot of DIY step-by-step sessions, how to do pedal access, how to do phlebectomy, how to do sclerotherapy step-by-step, how-to sessions in wiring a complex CTO, choosing the right balloon for revascularization. You'll have case presentations throughout the week, and we'll have panel discussions as well as interactions with our faculty. And obviously, we want to be cutting edge, and that's very, very important. Renal denervation is right on the cusp. We're right there, and this is going to be change medicine. I think this is truly going to change how we practice medicine, and this is what we're launching our meeting with, and we're going to start that here pretty soon. Pedal access, you know, this is a hot topic right now. We're going to go through that quite a bit, as well as limb salvage throughout the course of today and tomorrow. We're going to have live and pre-recorded live cases with panel discussions and cover the latest clinical data. On Saturday, we have the carotid fellows course, which is full now, and we're going to be going through practical approaches of treating peripheral arterial disease with specific emphasis on carotid disease, and they're going to have a hands-on approach where we have a significant amount of simulators and hand-on models. I'm going to wrap up here pretty quickly, just a couple of housekeeping slides. In order to get your CME, you have to sign in every day. I know it's a pain, but you got to do it. Nurses, podiatrists, and radiology techs, you got to sign in twice a day. Sorry, but it's the rules. And then you have to complete your CME forms in order to get your CME. We have free Wi-Fi access, so if you're down here, you might have poor signal, so you can log into Wi-Fi. I think it's PSAV is what you're going to log into, and all caps, it's CVC 2013. Please join us this afternoon for welcome reception in the exhibit hall. Between 5 and 6, we're going to have cocktails available. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce and welcome my friend Tom McNamara, who will be presenting my mentor, Dr. Amir Matarjameh, one of the greatest interventional radiologists and peripheral vascular specialists, and one of the pioneers in endovascular intervention, and present him with the Lifetime Achievement Award, hopefully a little bit of a roast as well, but mostly the Lifetime Achievement Award.
Where is the award?
Right here. I'll get it to you.
Okay, fine. Well, good morning. This is indeed a special day for Jaffer, myself, and many of the people, Joe Roberts, for example, from industry, to talk about a great man and a tremendous contributor to the field that we're now getting a glimpse of many, many, many years after it was originally started. And these words describe Amir, I think, quite well. I could stop just after reading them, but I won't. Leader, innovator, teacher, an exemplary physician, and perhaps the last is actually what his true legacy will be. He was born in Iran. None of us hold that against him. In childhood, he was a fifth of seven children. Their parents kept producing better and better. They had a heavy emphasis on education, as evidenced by the fact that all seven became college graduates. His MD degree was from Shiraz Medical University, a wonderful, great city with a great history. Came to the U.S. just to get some additional training, planning to return to his family and heritage, but he met a couple of different U.S. girls, married them, not at the same time. He had family, job, success. He did consider that, I'm told. Someone told me that. At any rate, his U.S. training was centered really in Chicago. He was an intern at the Mount Sinai Hospital, and he took a brief residency in surgery. They thought he was much too good to be a surgeon, so sent him back to Chicago, where he took his residency at the Cook County Hospital, and then so he must have done well there to get a very prestigious fellowship in what was basically angiography at the time, but those are the basic skills one had to have to go on to intervention, which is one of the reasons the radiologists led in that for such a long time. But in 1967, he began practice at St. Anne's Hospital in Chicago and was there for 19 years. During that time, he established angiography, then performed the very first peripheral angioplasty in 1978 that followed closely on the heels of the first coronary angioplasty performed the same year in New York City by Simon Sturzer. And it happened to be the first in the world limb salvage treated with balloon angioplasty. The major coverage, which we'll get a glimpse of in a few minutes, by television, radio, newspapers, resulting in, of course, a tremendous amount of information to the general public, and his angioplasty exploded, which enabled him to then have the practice volume and access to patients to perform the first in the world angioplasty of the vertebral arteries. Even Andreas Grunzig was very impressed with that when Amir and he met at a meeting that Amir had organized with Charles Dotter in Chicago, first really international meeting. Grunzig was a guest faculty, and he therefore invited Amir back to what was then a very hard to get into course put on by Grunzig in Europe. He then performed, I don't know if he, it doesn't really matter, he was unaware of others doing subclavian artery balloon angioplasty, as were we. We thought we were the first out in Reno, Nevada, where all the riffraff live. But he'd performed the first, second, or third subclavian balloon angioplasty, but as far as he knew, it was the first. Then wrote, which was really a breakthrough article, on the combining angioplasty and surgery, rather than viewing them as competitive, and this is my turf, this is your turf, to actually work collaboratively, and he was a real role model in that combination of efforts. And actually, again, it was one of the first to use the trimodyne laser, and was in that first group of investigators. Made a major change in 1986. He founded the Midwest Vascular Institute, which still exists, and relocated to the Good Samaritan Hospital, stopped the practice of general radiology. That's almost unheard of for a radiologist. So he did not have a contract. He had no security, and he was outside of the mainstream of radiology, and as you'll see, he's taken really his own independent path throughout his career. And that was the first big step in that direction. So he was the first radiologist to provide independent office consultations, and he sought the primary responsibility for the patient's vascular diagnosis and care and follow-up. 1987, the following year, he did the initial human work with atherectomy. Look at all these firsts. Initial work with atherectomy. 1988, pioneered the technique of thrombolysis for chronic iliofemoral occlusions. Some people thought thrombolysis wouldn't work for chronic occlusions. I popularized, and it was regarded as the truth for quite some time, that if you probe the clot with a guide wire and you couldn't go through it, don't start. Just forget it. Take the ones that are soft. It is true that if they're soft enough to penetrate, then that's clot that's dissolvable. Many new people in the field, they don't quite realize now when they easily go through the occlusion, they think, oh, this is great and I'm so super, and they aren't aware of the fact that that is still a relatively soft clot, and that could, when you disturb it with a balloon, you could send that downstream. So they're always surprised at that. At any rate, so we played sort of yin and yang roles in thrombolysis. This was major innovation, developed this catheter, which was excellent at catheterizing the opposite iliac, used that to dissolve the clots in the opposite iliac artery. It's now been adapted to be used for many vessels, mesenteric, renal, et cetera. It's a mainstay, particularly for people who came to some of his initial courses. That's their workhorse catheter. Still available. You can purchase it through Merit. I get a nickel for saying that. Evolving expertise, 1989, he pioneered intravascular ultrasound, another pioneering effort. And it was the first to make a presentation on that at the Radiologic Society of North America, another first. And as a result of all of that, he was available. That's all he did. He was very good. He was increasingly known. He got increasing referrals from surgeons and radiologists for not the initial treatment, but for the failed, impossible cases from surrounding states. And that resulted in, of course, what's an impossible case, as we've just heard, the limb salvage cases. So he began to have a great deal of that sort of patient population. And they're either pre-amputation or failed amputation. So what was available? What more could you do after angioplasty? Who knew? Well, he became convinced that new techniques were needed, and he had the true compassion, and he had the courage, all of those who know him realize those are strong points in him. And so he tried new approaches. And I remember him saying to me many, many years ago, I was somewhat surprised he was going to try this or try that. He said, well, what does a patient have to lose if they fail? They're going to lose their leg anyway. And that justified his beginning things, which have turned out to work. For example, stents below the knee. In 1992, some 21 years ago, he put the first stent below the knee. At that time, the only stent available was the Palmaz stent. And this patient was, again, in a desperate situation, been hospitalized in another hospital for 2 or 3 months. One thing after another tried, none working. Patient presented with gangrene in the left toes, had a distal bypass, which had occluded, and at the distal anastomotic site, there was a big infection. Scheduled for amputation. This was just a quick look. Everybody's had breakfast. And so this was the challenge. Occlusion, as you can see, is this point? Maybe not. The occluded of the popliteal and a below knee portion of the popliteal. Angioplastied the popliteal and the origin of the trifurcation open, and then placed the first below the knee stent, which was a Palmaz, resulting in great flow. Healing, healed after a skin graft, 2 years, no amputations, and she loved him. She sent him a picture thanking him for saving both of her legs. He saved the other one at another time. And next year, 1993, 20 years ago, first true trifurcation stent. This was a patient, no vessels open. The middle image shows result after balloon angioplasty. He thought that was unsatisfactory. He was right. Placed a coronary stent designed by Gary Rubin. How long would that last? Well, a year later, while looking at the other side, he had a chance to take a look. Still open. Reinforced his belief that this was a method of treatment, an advancement that was worth pursuing. A why stent? Below the knee, by the way. Well, often, as you can see, the results after what looks like a perfectly well-done balloon angioplasty are not adequate. It's not really going to improve flow. What about the stents? Well, there was Palmaz stents, coronary stents. They're either too short, they could be crushed, they wouldn't bend, or they weren't long enough. So, cleverly, he took a different stent called the Magic Wall stents, designed to be used in the veins, which were used to perform a coronary artery bypass. They were flexible. They were not particularly rigid, but if they compressed them, they would come back. And if you oversize them, then they would be longer, so they could cover up to 8 centimeters, 80 millimeters. Very clever. That became his go-to stent, enabled him to get great results. Because of those great results, he became increasingly acknowledged as a leader in limb salvage, which wasn't, it's easy to say that now, but having lived through that with him, I would hear, and he would hear directly, criticism, skeptics. I think many times it was masking actually professional jealousy. Maybe yes, maybe no. At any rate, I had the honor of having him present at our live case conference in Los Angeles, his first presentation showing his results. The audience was wowed, and I was quite proud of him and what he'd done. Ongoing results were published in 1994, and now it's, as you well know, certainly standard care. Spurred industry to do more research and development. He now has such a huge practice, it's remarkable for a single individual. More than 3,000 patients who had critical limb ischemia, that is to say they were going to lose their leg, and over 500 stents below the knee. So when he talks about this, you should listen. He's acknowledged, of course, as an international expert. He's a leader in teaching, actually beginning to backtrack a bit. 1982, he organized with the then considered real guru, the father of angioplasty, Charles Dotter. He and Dr. Dotter together had the first international angioplasty meeting. It was in Chicago at the Ritz-Carlton. The meeting went on from 82 to 85. World leaders were invited. We'll get a chance to look at some of them later, but these are people from around the world. Grunzig really developed the first usable balloon angioplasty. Further down the list, there's Porstmann. He developed the first what's called caged balloon in East Germany. Zeitler was the one who daughter ran into tremendous opposition in this country. It was called Crazy Charlie, all kinds of ways to deride him. But in Europe, Eberhard Zeitler in Nuremberg thought this was a very good idea. Zeitler was a very smart guy, energetic, and committed. And he really did a lot to popularize angioplasty before balloons in Europe. And actually, Grunzeck owed a good deal of his training to a year he spent with Zeitler. So these are the luminaries at the time. Van Andel developed a graduated tapered catheter, which was manufactured by Cook Catheter Company. And Robkin had his own contribution, which was an unusual stent. So these were really the big deals, and he was able to recruit them to come to this meeting. Then in 1989, after a four-year not performing a conference while he was establishing the Midwest Vascular Institute, he resumed the live cases, did the cases at Good Samaritan, and we'll see some this week. It went on for 10 years. Huge attendance. Why would that be? Well, it wasn't because they liked coming and seeing short guys present. It was where were you going to go? And where would you go see a live case and not just one? And hear experts, and Amir invited people who he knew would be totally opposed to, politely opposed, but most of the time, but opposed to what he was saying. And sometimes the discussions got pretty hot, but it was good. And everybody was invited. At that time, most of it was being done by radiologists. But it were 200 to 300 people. It was not a seat left. And many people who are now very big deals, justifiably, in peripheral interventional disease, some of whom will be presenting here, their initial exposure, and they now say in retrospect, inspiration. You know, they went to this meeting and they were interested, that's why they went, but they came back inspired, and they will all say that. And he would perform four cases a day for 3 days. And then all of you who are in practice realize practice doesn't stop and you don't really get a week off to get everything ready. So he would be working at night on his presentations the next day. And he was tired, but he did an excellent job, was grueling. And then there was a hiatus, and then fortunately for all of us, Dr. Golzar was kind enough to invite Amir to collaborate with him on this very fine meeting. So he was always in the vanguard, as you know. He would be where companies would send people to get taught and or certified in the use of their devices. And he's still participating now in the carotid stent trial, and he's got a new current innovation. It wouldn't be a mirror if it weren't controversial. So it is. And that is, with the stent grafts, he now says you should cover the lifeboat. Cover the distal anastomotic connection with the distal vessel. And however, if you look at this graft, which goes on out to 36 months in follow-up, the top grouping is for the non-covered collateral. Just put the stent in, do its standard, don't cover the collaterals. Well, at 2 years, 57% are open. If you covered the collaterals, 80% are open. I'm surprised at this, actually. What I'm surprised about is that when the bottom group does occlude, that they wouldn't be more ischemic, and he assures us that that's not the case. So this is a big deal. His conclusion, covering the collaterals immediately distal to the stent graft, prevents establishment of real competitive flow. And you'll know, the reason that the vessels occlude to begin with is that the main channel narrows, body's pretty smart, develops collateral flow. When the two flows are about even, then that's called competitive flow. Particularly with a foreign body in the main channel, gee, that's a combination for thrombosis. And we used to see that a lot with the PTFE FemPop grafts, and that's how many of us cut our teeth with lysis. But at any rate, this is a unique idea. It's another game changer. So testimonials, many, and the people from his office staff who worked with him can attest to that. They would come back so grateful, save my leg, save my life, save my mojo, so I could keep my wife. He always liked that one. And many physicians visit his lab to learn angioplasty, thrombolysis, laser, you name it. They all praised, just justly they should have, is superb skills, generosity in teaching, kindness to the patients, and the people from his office can attest to that as well. Candor, you better believe it, and sense of humor. So Amir, you've been a model. Physician, worked tirelessly to change the practice of medicine, saving lives and limbs. Jaffer, read the rest of it.
Amir has been a model physician, worked tirelessly to change the practice of medicine. He truly has. He saves limbs, saves lives, and teaches others to do the same. He had the vision, the courage, and the innovativeness to develop new and needed treatments, and he still does. Had the strength and courage not to accept limits set by others. Thank you very much. Congratulations.
And now there'll be a little frosting on the cake. Show the iMovie. More to come.
Tajmi is the man who opened the clogged artery. These x-rays show that the woman's artery, which was 75% blocked before the procedure, was much improved after the balloon pushed the plug away. Dr. Matajmi has been ready to use the balloon for some time. The stumbling block, he says, has been the difficulty in convincing the doctors who refer the patient that it works.
I don't blame them to avoid any new procedure. They would like to go with type of the procedures that they are familiar with, and they know the result, and they have seen it for many years.
Dr. Chester Gruska has been a family practitioner for 25 years. When he read a Time magazine article about the doctors in New York, he began searching through medical journals. Convinced that it might work, he referred his patient to Dr. Matajmi, and he thinks it's something that could benefit more and more people.
Well, it means that the patient will not have to undergo surgery. At the same time, the pain problems related to surgery will be diminished.
And now his patient, 73-year-old Ruth O'Grady, is ready to leave St. Anne's. The circulation turning to her leg. The pain is easing, thanks to the artery balloon, whose experimental and revolutionary use in treating heart disease has reopened interest in this less costly and less dramatic procedure to treat other clogged arteries.
The material blocking the artery into the artery wall, but the balloon won't work if the artery is completely closed. Enter the laser, now being tested by the same Chicago radiologist at the same hospital.
Jack? Laser.
For the 82-year-old man on the table, the vaporizing energy of the laser may mean the difference between saving and losing a leg.
He has a very long standing blockage there and no open arteries below that point.
The arteries in his left leg are so blocked that the standard inflatable artery opening balloon couldn't penetrate the clogs. Surgery to bypass packages failed, so he was referred to radiologist Dr. Amir Matajmi, pioneering the use of lasers in opening leg arteries. Before he started, he wasn't sure even the laser would work in this case.
If you thought of me now, it's all open now.
Could you have done that before laser?
Never.
So the laser might be saving his left leg.
Exactly.
For nearly a decade now, I've been following the pioneering work of a Chicago area radiologist who's been testing various artery cleaners. As with the others, the first experimental step begins in the leg. Over the past 10 years, major arteries in Marie Bergen's legs became increasingly blocked. The pain made walking more and more difficult.
Yeah, I couldn't walk very far. Maybe a half a block was all I could walk. And going up and down the steps was very difficult.
2 weeks ago, Marie became the first person to have an artery blockage treated with a rotating artery cleaner.
This is the very first device that really removes the diseased portion of the artery. It does not remodel it. It does not burn it. It just takes it out and bring it out. And that's why I think this is going to work better than other devices.
Controversial. These are all major, major figures. Thank you.
radiologist, Dr. Amir Matajmi, has treated almost 4,000 patients, not with a scalpel, but with the clot-dissolving drug urokinase. The drug, like its cousin streptokinase that's used in heart attack patients, dissolves clots obstructing arteries already clogged by atherosclerosis. It's extremely successful in opening up blocked arteries to the legs.
We have documented that some of the clots up to 8 years can be treated with this medication combination with maceration of the clot. In other words, we break the clot into small pieces.
Amir, would you come to the podium? We have a presentation to make.
This is a, I guess we'll have to use the mic.
I'm pleased to have been asked to present this beautiful award that Jaffer has put together, a Lifetime Achievement Award presented to Dr. Amir Matajmi in recognition of years of distinguished, and I can't read so well in the dark, dedication and contributions to the field of endovascular medicine, presented on July 10th, 2013.
Thank you very much. I was afraid happened to me what happened to Tom when he got excited, you know, instead of me, and so that helped me to stay calm. Thank you very much, Tom. Thank you. Jaffer asked me to talk about, you know, the past and what we learned from the past and future, and what I'm going to say, Tom practically covered everything, and so I'm, you might, you know, see the same thing, or maybe even some pictures, some slides again. But I'll put it on the sort of the medical aspect of it. All started with this man, Charles Dodder. He was a radiologist, vascular radiology, interventional radiology. Those days, there was no intervention. All we did was angiography. And he published an article in 1964, described a percutaneous technique for opening block arteries. And all started with this angiogram. He did this arteriogram on a patient who had severe claudication of the right leg. And next day when he was making the round, the patient in the hall walking and stopped and said, "Doc, what did you do to me?" And he looked at the patient, surprised. He said, "You know, I can walk a lot better than I did before now. Going up and down in the hall, and I don't have that much pain." Dr. Dodder, being a visionary, probably if someone would have told us this, we would just let it go thinking, well, this guy thinks he's better, but he thought about it and he immediately realized what has happened. He realized by putting a catheter bigger than a tiny lumen of the artery, he dilated that lumen. And that's why on an arteriogram, you don't really see anything, any flow on the right iliac artery, although he was able to get into and do arteriogram. So the reason was that the catheter was bigger than the lumen of the artery that caused dilatation. And he immediately understood what happened to this patient and what he can do, you know, with that. That's how he described the what's happening with the angioplasty. Of course, he thought that you can compress the plaque and open up the artery. Of course, the physiology of the angioplasty is not what he described, but that's what he believed. And he went on and he made a coaxial catheter system. He put a 7 French catheter in and the 12 French catheter on top of that. And this way dilated the arteries. Of course, European made a different type of the catheters, a taper one, especially Van Andel catheter. It's very, very famous catheter, has been, you know, around for many years. And as Tom mentioned, no one really was giving Dr. Daughter any credit to what he did, and no one was doing what he advised. He probably, in the United States, for about 10 years, he was the only one who was doing this type of balloon, catheter angioplasty. But European took that and run with it. We really owe it to some of the European collaborators. Dr. Zeitler was the top man in Europe doing this procedure, and then Dr. Portsman was East Germany, and Van Andel, very well known because of his Van Andel catheter that for years people were using that, and Dr. Horvath, he was from Hungary, and Dr. McNamara showed you some pictures of all of them. Portsman was the first one who made a balloon catheter. His balloon catheter was called Corset, and that's how he was. He made 4 slits in a catheter, then it just like a old tires that they had an inner tube, and this had an inner balloon, and coincide with those slits, and when you inflate the balloon and dilate it. Dr. Daughter used this balloon for dilating the iliac arteries, which were not, you know, responding pretty good with the stiff, straight catheters, and he published his article in 1974 about the angioplasty of the iliac arteries with that Portsman Corset balloon. These are 3 pillars of the angioplasty, and we owe them, you know, what we have today. Dr. Daughter for introducing the procedures, and Dr. Zeitler would keep it alive in Europe, and Dr. Grunzig made a balloon catheter. Actually, he made his balloon in 1974. In 1977, he published his article about the peripheral angioplasty with Grunzig balloon, and in 1978, he, in a letter, actually not a regular article, to Lancet, he described what he's doing in coronary arteries. As Tom mentioned, the first balloon angioplasty in the United States was done in New York. This, what you see here, is a renal form of the Grunzig system. It was a guiding catheter, and the balloon catheter was inserted through that. It was in June 15, 1978, when Simon Stessel did the very first coronary angioplasty in Lenox Hill Hospital in New York. And this was unbelievable medical news at that time. And it was in New York Times, in Walter Cronkite on CBS, covered that, and practically any other important newspaper or magazine, and they did that. They reported that. Just was in the right place and the right time. I did, as usual, arteriogram, and this is what you saw on the television coverage. I did this angiogram on a woman who had ischemic ulcer, and those days practice was you have a patient with a vascular disease, you call vascular surgeon order arteriograms. We did the arteriogram, and surgeon went and did the bypass surgery. And I did the same thing, you know, I did this arteriogram, and surgeon went to a patient and told him that you need a bypass surgery. And she said, but this time was different. She said, no, I'm not going to have any bypass surgery. They said, well, you're going to lose your leg. And she said, well, if I have to lose my leg, I have to lose my leg. And she refused surgery. I was approached by the general practitioner that you saw that clip. And he came to me and he said, Amir, do you know anything about this procedure that it was all over newspapers and television? I said, you mean angioplasty? And he said, yeah. I said, of course I know. And he said, you mean you can do it? I said, sure I can do it. And he said, you know that Mrs. O'Grady, that was patient's name, refused surgery. And I wonder if she will let you do this procedure on her. I said, well, why don't you go talk to her? So he went and came back and he said, Amir, she said she will have it done as long as it's not surgery. I said, great. So I scheduled the patient and got the patient in the room. I had a technologist, Gary Heinemann, who scrubbed with me in every single case that I've done in my first 10 years. And I brought the patient in. I said, Gary, lock the door. Never done angioplasty, never seen one. The only thing I was doing those days, I was following Dr. Daughter anywhere he gave a lecture, I was there listening to it. I was really fascinated by this procedure, and I was going to do it. And I had a very close friend who was a cardiovascular surgeon, and I asked him many times, let me try, and even with patients that were going to amputate their leg, they would not let me do that. So I wasn't going to let this opportunity get away. You know, and that was the bloodiest procedure up to today I've ever done in my life. Didn't know how to do downstream puncture, never seen them. I didn't know where you're supposed to puncture the artery going there. On top of that, when I got in, the only thing I had in my lab was this one cage balloon only, which I bought this because of the Charlie Daughter's article. That's the only thing I had, and God knows for how long this has been in that lab. And when I finally got this. You know, we didn't have arterial sheath those days. Everything was put in percutaneous without any sheath. Sheath was for cardiologists, not for us radiologists. I didn't even have one in my lab. So when I put that in, finally got it in, and we inject the contrast through that and mark the patients with a surgical clip, the catheter was short. The catheter was not reaching the lesion. So we stood there, looked at each other, Gary and I. So what are we going to do? I said, you know what, Gary? You push over her belly, and I push this catheter further down. And that's exactly how we did it. I got this down over the lesion and dilated that balloon for only 7 seconds. And deflated that, and we injected, we got that result. And that's where we took off. And since that was on television, since that was the first one done in the entire Midwest area, I know there were some other radiologists doing angioplasty at that time, started doing. Barry Katzen was one of them. But in our area, I was the first one who did that. So because of that, we got a lot of the media coverage. And not knowing, after my PR man sent the news release out, not knowing that all the television stations and newspapers, reporters, they were looking for something like that to report. So I had all these television station people lining up to interview me. So one night I was on NBC, one night I was a CBS, ABC, but anyhow, so I got a large, large volume of patient referral. That's why I had the opportunity to do what I did. And that was the, so because of that, I had patient of my own from day one, and I was the one who was evaluating the patient and taking care of the patient. One thing I did, every single case that I did angioplasty, prior to that, I talked to my friend, cardiovascular surgeon, Paul Naffa. I said, Paul, if I do this, this happened, this goes wrong, can you fix it? If he said yes, don't worry about it, go ahead, I did. If he said no, I didn't do that. I never jeopardized patients' well-being. And I was there to help them, not to cause problem, to benefit from that. This was angioplasty number 5 I did. Number 5. And that was a total occlusion. I tried it. I formed the J-wire and the catheter combination. That became my own technique for doing total occlusion, and it worked, and it still works. The problem was this. The balloons were big, the shaft was 7 French, they had bulky balloon, big shoulder, we couldn't cross some of the tight stenosis. So some of us started making suggestion to the company, making Barry Katzen suggested that we should make balloon longer. The first 10 cm long balloon came and bore his name, called the Katzen balloon. I made the very first tapered balloon catheter. That balloon catheter started with the shaft, the size of the shaft gradually get bigger to anywhere 4 to 6 millimeter balloon. And did a lot of good, we did a lot of good thing with that, as we did the vertebral angioplasty. This is the case number 2 that I did, and it was covered. I published that article in 1981 because I did it actually in 79, the first one. And after 1980, I wanted to publish that. The editor of radiology was, you know, was hesitant about publishing. In a letter he wrote to me, he said, I'm afraid to publish your article, and radiologists think that they can go ahead and dilate all these arteries and kill patients. So it took a lot of the time and negotiation back and forth. Finally, that article was published in Work in Process. That gave me the opportunity to meet Dr. Dodder, and we became very close friends, and we put that meeting that Tom was talking about for the first time in 1982. Then when we got, finally, we were able to get hold of some of the coronary balloons, because at the beginning, they wouldn't sell the balloon to us. And Schneider was really controlling who buys coronary balloons, who uses that. But anyhow, when we got the coronary balloon, we were able to go ahead and do the even distal vertebral arteries. This is how everything happens. 64 percutaneous transluminal angioplasty was induced by Dr. Dodder. Then we had the balloon angioplasty in 74. Catheter-directed local thrombolysis was, again, written up by Dr. Dodder in 1974. And atherectomy, John Simpson atherectomy, was introduced in 1985. And laser-assisted PTA, that was a hot tip laser, was in 87. Stent, Julio's stent became available in 1992. And stent grafts, wall graft, became available in 1995. This was original Simpson atherectomy. And that's all you were able to do, a very short segment, very tiny pieces of atheroma. It really, this was okay for coronaries, but it really didn't have any place in peripheral arteries, because we have extensive occlusions and long arteries. If you want to do atherectomy, you have to spend 2 hours, 3 hours at that. But I work on, as Tom mentioned, I worked on a barred rotary atherectomy system. That was a very nice atherectomy. It was a cutter that it cut the plaques over an auger wire. As it did, it wrapped around the wire, and you pulled the wire out, and everything came out just like a shish kebab. And for some reason that this, you see that cases like this, we did that, very good result. I couldn't understand, I still don't, for some reason, Bart decided to drop this, and they didn't go forward with it. Until John Simpson again made the Silverhawk atherectomy catheter that today, you have an artery like this, top to bottom disease, you can take damage of the atheromas out and get a pretty good result. Doesn't mean that the artery is going to stay open a lot longer. No. We're looking forward to see maybe combination of this atherectomy and drug-eluting balloons. Maybe that will give us what we're really looking for. And really, today we have so many different devices. We can cut them, we can sand them. You heard about the CSI device. I use them very often in calcified lesions. And there are so many other devices. These are all niche devices that are good for some particular situation. The devices are at our is available to that, as you see here, stent grafts, plaque excision, atherectomy, laser, ultrasound thrombolysis, and one other thing that we'll talk about, stents. I don't know if today really we're able to do the things we do without stents. Probably one of the biggest contribution after introduction of the percutaneous angioplasty by a daughter and balloon by Gronsig, this probably is one of the best thing happened to us. But, you know, sometimes we look at things differently. We go a wrong way. And this was published in 2008, was a 10 randomized trial were reviewed. As a matter of fact, Bard sponsored this, spent tons of money, because this was done with one of the Bard's stents. What they did on these studies, they tried it on lesions. The average lesion for stent was 45, 49, 46 millimeter long. And they did the balloon, compare them to the balloon on lesions about 43 millimeter long. This is their conclusion. They came away that there was no difference between doing stent and doing a balloon angioplasty. It wasn't because stent was not good. It was because balloon is really good in short lesions. Look at this one. In 1994, I recanalized this lesion, did a balloon angioplasty. I was seeing this patient every 6 months. This ultrasound is in 2002. Artery was still open, triphasic waveforms. Patient never had problem until she died from CA of the lung. So we knew that. We review our own total occlusion SFA, and we use three different modalities in a large number of patients. And we knew the 5 years patency rate of stent after balloon angioplasty was superior to doing lytic therapy and angioplasty, or doing lytic therapy, angioplasty, and provisional stenting. So doing balloon angioplasty and covering with stent gave us much better result. This was one of the cases that I did, was total occlusion from the groin all the way down below the knee. And we can't do without stent. This is an aortic lesion, was done with stent, took only 10 minutes, and stays open for a long time. Very complex iliac lesions can be handled with the stents, like this one. We re-canalize short iliac artery occlusions, long iliac artery occlusions. These are all done with stent. I do it with combination with lytic therapy. I got a 79% patency rate after 5 years, and a secondary patency, 91%. As good as surgery, and even better. How can we do renal angioplasty without stenting? And today, no one referred patient for bypass surgery. They all do stenting. And so, as Tom mentioned, some of the limb salvage cases without stent maybe not work that well. This is a woman who had corrective surgery because she had hammer toe deformities. And it was done by one of our really nice surgeon who knows what we do. We always, you know, work together. But without checking her circulation, went on and did the surgery. Now she has all these gangrenous changes. Look at the angiogram. There's nothing wrong with the SFA popliteal, but below the knee, she has only single peroneal artery, anterior tibial occluded, posterior tibial occluded, dorsal pedis is occluded, nothing in the foot. Well, we were able to recanalize that, balloon it, and put a long stent in it. This is what I'm doing now, since we don't have any devoted stents below the knee, any stents that is really made from the below the knee. I have no choice but borrow some of the peripheral long stents that we use above the knee and use them below the knee. So I did use this on that one, and this is the result I got. And here is she's in 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months totally healed. So we can't do that. Stent graft is another nice device that we have. We had a wall graft years back in 1995 started, and the cases like this, stent graft can save a major, major surgery. A patient who had large pseudoaneurysm and is aortobiliac graft, well, we put a wall graft and treated that. Now today, this is also an aneurysm of the popliteal artery that very easily can be treated with stent graft. Today we have Viable, and it's much better stent graft. We do a lot of the nice things with it. Ideal device among the devices that we have today for long SFA occlusion, for long diffuse disease, and we can do grafting like that as good as or better than Gore-Tex Fempop graft. This is a fascinating case. It's a patient who had aneurysmal disease, had aortic bifurcation graft for aneurysm of the aorta, then lost his right leg because of thrombosed popliteal aneurysm, and now facing with the problem like this. He again has thrombosed a popliteal aneurysm, and they are set to amputate his other leg. And I've never been so emotional when I saw this patient, because this old man was, you know, crying that because they want to cut his other leg off too. So what I did, was able to break through that, put him on the lytic therapy, and next morning I was able to see where the aneurysm was. I was able to see some distal runoff, and that was good enough for me. In stent grafting, what you need is a landing zone and a proximal. I don't care what is going on in between. And this is what I did. I put a Viabon, 8mm Viabon stent graft for him. I got a result like this. I was, at that time, I did an arteriogram. I was a little bit dubious that if this is really going to work or not, because the flow was very sluggish, very low. And sure enough, everything worked. This is a 3 years follow-up Doppler on this patient, and triphasic in the popliteal, in the anterior tibia, in the tibial peroneal trunk, and as you see, and I can't lie to you because my ultrasound tech is sitting right there, and she's the one who's doing all this. But anyhow, 3 years open. I started from there as a young man with a one single balloon. Today I'm surrounded with all these technologies, equipment, gray hair, and in conclusion, I can tell you that endovascular treatments are minimally invasive procedure replacing major reconstructive surgery at lower cost, lower mortality, morbidity rate, but I believe, the best yet to come. We're looking forward to gene modification that maybe would be able to eliminate the atherosclerosis completely, or to a treatment like atherolysis that we're able to lyse the plaques rather than cutting them, sanding them, breaking them, doing all, just lyse them. And let's get together and drink to that day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Matarjme. So at this point, we'll go ahead and start our general sessions. So as you know, the arterial session will be in here, and the venous sessions will be next door. The general sessions will start at 10 a.m., which is a couple of minutes. So if we want to go ahead and get started, and Dr. Shimshak will be moderating the renal denervation session.